Hello, this is Dave. This video is intended primarily for my brothers and sisters who have discovered that they are the true descendants of the Hebrew Israelites of the book known as the Old Testament, and for those of other nations who fear and follow the commandments of the Most High, but are still believers in the character known as Jesus or Yeshua, Yahawashiah, Yahusha, Yahoshua, or Yeshaya. However, if you are a born-again, saved, white Anglo-Saxon Christian type, then don't bother watching this video. It's not for you. There's no point in arguing with anything that's in this video, because the contents are based on the way of life of the Hebrews, and you are in a religion that worships a pantheon of gods entirely different from the Most High I Am of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I have no interest in any debate with Christians. What you choose to believe is your own affair. So don't come on here and tell me that I need to be saved, or I haven't done enough research, or I haven't been possessed by the holy demon spirit yet. I don't need you to pray to your idol for me. I don't need to be born again. I just need you to go away. So, I was fortunate enough not to have been indoctrinated into a religion. My mother was a non-practicing Catholic who decided to allow her children to figure out what they wanted to believe. So for me, at the age of 13, after researching many religions, I decided that they were all control systems. So I was an atheist for 40 years, and I wanted nothing to do with religions or Bibles. But over the course of my 15 years of truth-seeking, the Bible was presented to me three times. The first time was when I was researching the perfection of the human body. And after learning about urine therapy, somebody mentioned to me, "You know urine therapy is in the Bible, don't you?" And I was like, "Really?" So I checked it out and there it was. Proverbs 5:15, "Drink from your own cistern, flowing waters from your own well." And just in case you think that verse means something else, if you look up the words for waters, mayim, it means bodily fluids, urine. So number two was that somebody told me that King James, the 6th of Scotland and the 1st of England, the one who authorized the King James 1611 Bible, was a black man. Now, of course, I didn't believe it. I had seen the painting of him in the National Portrait Gallery, but after doing a little research, I found engravings of the man that couldn't have been whitewashed. And sure enough, he was a black man, and his wife, Anne of Denmark, was a black woman with an afro. The third time was after I discovered that the earth was flat. Somebody told me, "You know the Bible's a flat earth book, don't you?" Again, I was like, "Really?" So I checked, and sure enough, the Bible describes the earth as a motionless circle set on pillars with a dome over it. Now, whenever something presents itself to me three times, I kind of take that as a sign that I should pay attention to it. So I decided to actually read the Bible for the first time ever from cover to cover. And when I did so, several things struck me. I was surprised to find that it was a straightforward and easily comprehensible literal story. It also seemed obvious to me that the New Testament was a separate and unrelated book, and it was a so-called Old Testament which was the book that deserved further investigation. The Book of Remembrance is the real name of the so-called Old Testament, and you can find that in Malachi 3:16. "Then they that feared the Most High spake often one to another, and the Most High hearkened and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared the Most High and thought upon his name." In my opinion, the Book of Remembrance also includes the books of the Apocrypha, that's 14 books that were in the original 1611, but removed from later versions, and also the books of Enoch, Jubilees, and Jasher from the Dead Sea Scrolls found in 1947. When one reads the Book of Remembrance without the lenses of Christian doctrine, it's obvious that it's a story that follows the trials and tribulations of one bloodline, one particular group of people, beginning with Adam, through to the end days. The New Testament, however, is an entirely different book, written in a different language, in a completely foreign style. And while it claims to be a continuation of the Book of Remembrance, it's suddenly no longer about those people at all. And thousands of years of history and genealogy is casually tossed aside. It begins by introducing a new central character and desperately tries to convince the reader that he's not new at all. But not only was he there all along from the beginning, but he was also what the newly renamed Old Testament was all about. And it's just a coincidence that the Most High and all the prophets absent-mindedly forgot to mention him by name. In this new book, written by Greeks and edited by Romans, the Most High doesn't say a single word, and he's described as an entity of an entirely different character to the Most High I Am of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. This God is now represented by the book's new central character, Jesus, who is conceived in exactly the same manner as the Most High regarded as a grievous sin, demands that we praise him as the Most High's sales rep and publicist, in exactly the way the Most High commanded us not to, and died for everyone's sins in exactly the way the Most High said that no man could. It becomes painfully obvious to anyone not blinded by the word magic of Christian doctrine that the New Testament concerns a new Greco-Roman pantheon of gods, the benevolent, all-loving, all-forgiving, yet unnamed Father God, another unnamed God described as a Holy Spirit, who, curiously enough, goes round possessing people and raping young women in exactly the same manner as the Greco-Roman gods did, the Son, S-U-N, Jesus, whose name sounds suspiciously similar to the Greek words Iusus, which means Son of Zeus, or Son of the Supreme Deity of, you guessed it, the Greeks. Zeus is also a synonym of the word Deus, another word for the last god in this pantheon, the devil, which the Book of Remembrance reveals as a particular nation of deceivers, not an individual. In fact, the word devil doesn't appear in the Old Testament. It's the word devils, plural. It has to be considered that the authors of the New Testament had access to the Book of Remembrance when they wrote it. And it becomes obvious that whole passages were lifted from the Book of Remembrance, the Book of Enoch, and no doubt other suppressed books, to give it the air of authenticity. The acts and works of the character known as Jesus are directly taken from the book of Joshua, whose name, quite coincidentally, is that which the name Jesus is supposedly based on. There are also supposedly hundreds of prophecies concerning Jesus, and nobody seems able to agree on the exact number, that the New Testament claims are alluded to in the Old Testament, which would seem like overwhelming evidence, but for the fact that each one of these so-called prophecies, when studied individually, turn out to be isolated verses taken out of context and out of time and misapplied as prophecies of a character that wouldn't be born until hundreds if not thousands of years later. The deception is compounded by Christian scholars translating later versions of the Old Testament and using wording that supports their Christian bias. Interestingly, the oldest copy of the New Testament, the Codex Sinaiticus, contains no reference to the divinity or ascension of this Christ figure. These details, as well as many other key verses supporting the Jesus myth, were added later by zealous Christians. Word magic deception is the creative use of words to create a false reality in the minds of those that listen to them. For example, a hypnotist using the right combination of words can suggest that a raw onion is in fact a delicious apple. And for his victim, it will become his reality. Other examples are somewhat more subtle, such as a policeman who continues to beat or tase an obviously incapacitated suspect while shouting, "Stop resisting! Stop resisting!" This creates doubt and mental confusion, and so, in the minds of the onlookers, the reality shifts from a psychopath in uniform torturing an innocent to a belligerent suspect resisting a police officer performing a lawful arrest. Another form of word magic occurs when an elaborate scenario is constructed that convinces somebody that a physical act means something other than the action being performed. Thus, a paedophilic homosexual act of child molestation is imagined to be normal and natural simply because the sexual predator has the fancy title of moel, is performing a circumcision and sucking the blood from the infant boy's penis, and there's a fancy ritual with special clothes, none of which appears in the Book of Remembrance, which means it was made up by the mind of men. Word magic is heavily employed throughout the New Testament, but its most destructive use is in the Book of John. John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come unto the Father but by me. Well, he looks homosexual, so what do you want? Christians take this verse to mean that in order to praise, worship, or pray to the New Testament God, one must direct prayers to Jesus, and he will presumably email them to his dad. The Christian dutifully addresses all prayers to Jesus Christ, keeps idolatrous images around their necks or in their homes, and credits Jesus for any good fortune, blissfully unaware that they're in fact sinning by breaking the first and most important of the commandments. Exodus chapter 20, verses 3 and 4. Thou shalt not have any other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in the heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the waters under the earth. The Book of Remembrance serves as a book of law and history for a very particular people. It details the complete story from beginning to end of that people over the course of a millennial week, 6,000 years of work, and 1,000 years of rest. However, according to the New Testament, the Book of Remembrance is solely there to support it. The story that had been progressing for nearly 4,000 years is now abandoned and is no longer important. And a new story that directly contradicts the first, as well as the word of the Most High, is presented as the true purpose of the entire text, along with the surprise introduction of a new character who acts as the Most High's theatrical agent or representative. And all of this is substantiated by isolated verses from the Book of Remembrance, which must be taken out of their original context so that they might allude to its authenticity. The more I read of the New Testament, the more contradictions and anomalies I found, and the Jesus character made less and less sense. So this is my dissection of the New Testament, and in particular of the Jesus character. Now, you may be one of those who think you've broken away from Christianity and now have what would be considered a more accurate skin colour for the Jesus character, or a Hebrew-sounding name for him, such as Yeshua, Yahusha, Yeshaya, Yahusha, or Yehoshai. But unless an alternate history and timeline is provided for him that differs significantly from that of Jesus, then it doesn't matter what colour you make him or what you call him. It's the same Christ, and you are still a Christian. The clue is in the name Christian. So, let's start with this individual's identity. The name Jesus is not the name of a Hebrew from the first century Judea, but it's a Greek name, and even that name was not Jesus, but Iusus, which means son of Zeus. The letter J wasn't invented till 400 years ago, so the name Jesus is fake. I mean, if Peter Sutcliffe, the Yorkshire Ripper, decided to put on a dress and a grey wig and call himself Mother Teresa, would that mean that he was no longer an evil serial killer? No, of course not, because underneath the disguise and behind the alias is the same character. The face that is associated with the name turns out to belong to one Cesare Borgia, a notorious tyrant and paedophile and murderer from the Borgia crime family. His father was Rodrigo Borgia, who became Pope Alexander VI. And after the death of his favourite son, Cesare, he commissioned Cesare's homosexual lover, Leonardo da Vinci, to produce artwork depicting his son as Jesus. So the face is fake too. So let's look at the first verse of the New Testament. Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. The book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. The next verses supposedly show the genealogy of Jesus, but right away we run into a problem. This genealogy does not match the one in 1 Chronicles chapter 3, verses 11 to 12. This is important because in Matthew chapter 1, verse 17, it says, "So all the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations, and from David until the carrying away into Babylon are 14 generations, and from the carrying away into Babylon unto Christ are 14 generations." Now that sounds all prophetic and Jesus-like, but it's simply not true, because of all the generations that Matthew left out. That is Joash, Amaziah, Azariah, and Jehoiakim, according to 1 Chronicles chapter 3, 11-12. The lineage also includes someone called Jechonias, but in Jeremiah chapter 22, verses 24-30, Jechonias was cursed, he and all of his seed that will never sit upon the throne of David. So if Jechonias is in the lineage of Jesus, then Jesus would be cursed. Fortunately, Luke chapter 3, verses 23-38 comes to the rescue with a completely different genealogy. However, this genealogy cannot be the correct one for Jesus either, as it passes from David to Nathan. But in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 12-16, it says that one of David's descendants will be raised up, build a temple, and his throne will be secured forever, even if he disobeys. In 1 Chronicles chapter 22, verses 9-10, the Most High tells that it will be Solomon who will build the temple, and it will be his throne that will be secured. So Jesus cannot descend from Nathan. In any case, both genealogies are that of Joseph, not Jesus, since Joseph apparently never contributed any of his DNA or seed to Jesus. That means Jesus cannot be of the tribe of Judah or the seed of David. Some Christian apologists claim that the genealogy in Luke is that of Mary, and that Jesus is of the tribe of Judah and the seed of David through her. But putting aside the fact that lineage is counted through the father and not the mother, there are no women begetting anyone anywhere in the Book of Remembrance. There is nothing in the New Testament that suggests that Mary is of the tribe of Judah. However, there is evidence that she is in fact a Levite. Luke chapter 1, verse 5. There was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest called Zacharias of the course of Abia. And his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And if we go down to Luke chapter 1, verses 34-36, it says, "Then Mary said unto the angel, How should this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. And therefore also the holy thing that shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth." So, Zacharias was a priest, a Levite, son of Aaron. And his wife, Elizabeth, was a daughter of Aaron too, also a Levite. And Mary was her cousin, a Levite. Levites, especially the children of Aaron, were not allowed to marry other than Levites. Thus Mary was a Levite. So, even if we assume that the lineage in Matthew is Joseph's and the one in Luke is Mary's, then there's a 15-generation difference between Joseph and Mary, 11 if you include the generations that Matthew left out, which, if there's 20 years in a generation, then Joseph came along 220 to 300 years before Mary. The conclusion is Jesus is not of the tribe of Judah or the seed of David. The next claim to look at is the virgin birth. Matthew chapter 1 verse 18 tells that Jesus was born of a virgin and claims that it is a fulfillment of the prophecy in Isaiah chapter 7 verse 14. However, Isaiah 7:14 was a very specific prophecy to King Ahaz, which was given in his days and fulfilled in his days. Isaiah 7:14. Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. The word used in Isaiah 7:14 that was translated into the English word virgin is the Hebrew word Alma, which just means a young woman. And that young woman turned out to be Isaiah's wife. And their children's names were given as signs and prophecies. That's Isaiah chapter 8, verse 18. Emmanuel means the Most High is with us, which is the reassurance to King Ahaz that the plans of Israel and Syria would not come to pass and their kings will be removed. The rest of the chapter gives a specific timeline for those events and described how the kings are removed. This was not a prophecy of Jesus. If it were, then the question has to be asked. If the Most High prophesies the coming of Jesus in Isaiah 7:14, then he commanded them that the name shall be Emmanuel. So why did this not come to pass? Apart from Matthew's reference of Isaiah 7:14, nowhere in the New Testament is Jesus referred to as Emmanuel. So that would make the Most High a liar and a false prophet. Nowhere else in the New Testament does it say that Jesus was born of a virgin. In Luke, it says something completely different. Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 28. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. And a virgin's name was Mary. So Mary was a virgin up to this point. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail thou that art highly favoured, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women. So Luke says that Mary was a virgin, engaged to Joseph, and then the angel Gabriel came in unto Mary, and then she conceived. Now this wording is very specific. It's often used to signify intercourse, such as in Genesis chapter 6 verse 4. When the angels had sex with women. Genesis chapter 6 verse 4. There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them. The same became mighty men which were of old, men of renown. And also Genesis 38:18, when Judah impregnated Tamar. Genesis chapter 38 verse 18. And he said, What pledge shall I give thee? And she said, Thy signet, and thy bracelets, and thy staff, which is in thine hand. And he gave it her, and came in unto her, and she conceived by him. Note that we still use the same terminology today, except some spell it C-U-M and not C-O-M-E. So Luke doesn't say it was a virgin birth. He says that Mary was a virgin up until the point where the angel Gabriel impregnated her. Which also begs the question, why didn't Jesus become a 450-foot bloodthirsty Nephilim giant? But let's pull that aside and assume that the text does say that Mary was a virgin and the Most High impregnated her. Well, this would make no sense either, because after the angels had sex with women and begat children, the book of Enoch goes into much more detail about this event and how the Most High considered it a grievous sin, and so he punished those angels so harshly that it made Michael tremble. So why would the Most High commit the same sin? The Most High does not change, Malachi chapter 3 verse 6, so his judgment on this sin stands forever. According to Matthew, Joseph was already married to Mary, but he did not have sex with her until after Jesus was born. Matthew chapter 1, verses 24 and 25. Then Joseph being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. So why would the Most High lay down a commandment, thou shalt not commit adultery, and then break it himself by impregnating another man's wife? My conclusion is that Jesus was not born of a virgin. So that neatly leads on to the claim that Jesus is the only begotten Son of the Most High. John chapter 3 verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. However, the Most High himself says in Exodus chapter 4 verse 22, And thou shalt say unto Pharaoh, that thus saith the Lord, Israel is my son, even my firstborn. So among all the nations, the Most High considers the children of Israel to be his firstborn son. But if that's not specific enough for you, in Jeremiah chapter 31 verse 9, They shall come with weeping, and with supplications will I lead them. I will cause them to walk by the river of waters in a straight way, wherein they shall not stumble, for I am father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn. So, out of all the tribes of Israel, the Most High considers the tribe of Ephraim to be his firstborn. And out of all the people, he chose David as his firstborn. Psalm chapter 89, verses 21 to 27. I have found David my servant, and with my holy oil have I anointed him, with whom my hand shall be established, mine arm also shall strengthen him. The enemy shall not exact upon him, nor the son of wickedness afflict him. And I will beat down his foes before his face, and plague them that hate him. But my faithfulness and my mercy shall be with him, and in my name his horn shall be exalted. I will set his hand also in the sea, and his right hand in the rivers. He shall cry unto me, Thou art my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. Also I will make him my firstborn, higher than the kings of the earth. And David himself confirms this in Psalm chapter 2, verse 7. I will declare the decree, The Lord hath said unto me, that thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. So the Most High himself claims that David is his firstborn son. So how can Jesus come along and claim to be his firstborn son? Christian conspiracy theorists will point back to Genesis chapter 1 verse 26, where it says, Let us make man in our image and after our likeness. And they'll say that the plural means that Jesus was there with the Creator at the time of creation. However, not only is there nothing in scriptures that supports this idea, but neither Jesus or the Trinity is mentioned anywhere in this book that he's supposed to be pre-existing in. In fact, the Most High himself refutes the claim of the Trinity. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Also, if it was the case that Jesus, the Son of the Most High, was there at creation, why would the Most High refer to Israel, Ephraim, and David as his firstborn thousands of years later? Does the Most High have Alzheimer's? My conclusion here is that Jesus is not the Most High's firstborn son. It is also claimed that Jesus is the Saviour. Luke chapter 2 verse 11, For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Saviour, which is Christ the Lord. The Creator himself says numerous times that he himself is a Saviour and there is no other. Hosea chapter 13 verse 4, Yet I am the Lord thy God from the land of Egypt, and thou shalt know no God but me, for there is no Saviour beside me. Isaiah chapter 43 verse 3, For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Saviour. I gave Egypt for thy ransom, Ethiopia and Saba for thee. Isaiah chapter 43 verses 10 to 13, Ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that ye may know and believe me, and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. I, even I, am the Lord, and beside me there is no Saviour. I have declared, I have saved, and I have shewed, where there was no strange God among you. Therefore ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, that I am God. Yea, before the day was, I am he, and there is none that can deliver out of my hand. I will work, and who shall let it? Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6. Thus saith the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first, I am the last, and beside me there is no God. Isaiah chapter 45, verse 21. Tell ye and bring them near, yea, let them take counsel together. Who hath declared this from ancient time? Who hath told it from that time? Have not I the Lord? And there is no God else beside me. A just God and a Saviour, there is none beside me. Isaiah chapter 49, verse 26. And I shall feed them that oppress thee with their own flesh, and they shall be drunken with their own blood, as with sweet wine. And all flesh shall know that I, the Lord, am thy Saviour, and thy Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob. Isaiah chapter 60, verse 16. Thou shalt also suck the milk of Gentiles, and shalt suck the breast of kings, and thou shalt know that I, the Lord, am thy Saviour, and thy Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob. It's almost as though the Most High knew that there might be some kind of confusion about this in the future, and made sure to underline the point over and over. So how can Jesus claim to be the Saviour? And on that subject, when you ask a Christian the question, salvation from what, you get different answers. Salvation from death, salvation from sin, salvation from judgment. But they'll all shy away from the obvious reference in the Book of Remembrance that when the children of Israel are placed in their final period of captivity and affliction, then the Most High will save them and redeem them after 400 years. And that is coming to pass now. So my conclusion is, the Most High is the only Saviour, not Jesus. Some of the other aspects of this character's story are that with his arrival, the law of Moses and the covenant between the Most High and the children of Jacob are invalidated and replaced by a new covenant that included everybody who believes in Jesus. Christians will point to Jeremiah for confirmation of this. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 31. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. First of all, it's made clear that the new covenant, when it comes, will be with the children of Jacob and nobody else. But if one reads on, then the days of that new covenant are described in detail. Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 33 to 34. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts, and write it on their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbour, and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they will all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and remember their sin no more. Those days described most certainly do not match the world today. So the old covenant is still in effect, and therefore there is no such thing as grace, and virtually everything Jesus said is null and void. So is Jesus the Messiah? Well, firstly, what is a Messiah? In Greek, it is the word Christos, Christ in English, or the Mashiach in the Hebrew. The word Messiah just means anointed, that is, anointed by the Most High to perform a task. And there have been many messiahs, Saul, David, Solomon, King Cyrus, Zerubbabel, etc., etc. The Book of Remembrance speaks of no such character as this New Testament Messiah. It is a fictional composite character who is simultaneously a saviour, an avenger, king of the Israelites, high priest, and the Most High incarnated as a man, while also being his son, who prays to himself and then refuses to answer himself. And according to Matthew, would be back within the lifetime of his apostles. That's Matthew chapter 16, verse 28. Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste death till they see the Son of Man coming into his kingdom. Well, since the Christians are still waiting for Jesus to come back, that must mean that some of his disciples that were standing in front of him must be still around waiting. So where are these 2,000-year-old men now? Even if he came back, what would he be doing? It's already been established that he won't be the one who saves the children of Jacob from their captivity. He will not be the one who wreaks vengeance on the nations that oppressed his children. And he will not be the one risen up in the last days to become king of the Israelites. That again will be David, according to the Book of Remembrance. Jeremiah chapter 30, verses 7 to 9. Alas, for the day is great, so that none like it, even the time of Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it. For it shall come to pass in that day, saith the Lord of hosts, that I will break his yoke from off thy neck, and burst thy bonds, and strangers shall no more serve themselves of him, but they shall serve the Lord their God, and David their king, whom I shall raise up unto them. It doesn't say son of David, or seed of David, or the line of David, it just says David, and then clarifies which David by saying their king. Ezekiel chapter 34, verses 22 to 24. Therefore I will save my flock, and they shall no more be a prey, and I will judge between cattle and cattle, and I will set up one shepherd over them, and he shall feed them, even my servant David. He shall feed them, he shall be their shepherd, and I the Lord will be their God, and my servant David a prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken it. So, right there he specifies his servant David twice. But perhaps the Most High has defined another David as his servant. Psalms chapter 89, verse 20. I have found David, my servant, and with my holy oil have I anointed him. Well, no, it would seem not. Ezekiel chapter 37, verses 23 to 26. Neither shall they defile themselves any more with their idols, nor with their detestable things, nor with any of their transgressions. But I will save them out of all their dwelling places wherein they have sinned, and I will cleanse them, so they will be my people, and I will be their God. And David my servant shall be king over them, and they shall have one shepherd, and also walk with my judgments, observe my statutes, and do them. And they shall dwell in the land that I have given unto Jacob my servant, wherein your fathers have dwelt. And they will dwell therein, even they, and their children's children, forever. And my servant David shall be their prince forever. Moreover, I will make a covenant of peace with them, and it shall be an everlasting covenant with them. And I will place them and multiply them, and will set my sanctuary in the midst of them forevermore. Hosea chapter 3, verses 4 to 5. For the children of Israel shall abide many days without a king, and without a prince, and without a sacrifice, and without an image, and without an ephod, and without a teraphim. Afterwards shall the children of Israel return, and seek the Lord their God, and David their king, and shall fear the Lord and his goodness in the latter days. So David himself knows that he will be resurrected when he says in Psalms chapter 49, verse 15, But God will redeem my soul from the power of the grave, for he shall receive me, Selah. Now Christians will say that it doesn't mean David, but a descendant of David, and they'll point to something like Jeremiah as evidence. Jeremiah 23, verse 5. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will raise unto David a righteous branch, and a king shall reign and prosper, and shall execute judgment and justice in the earth. And so the word unto signifies that it's not David himself, but a branch of David's bloodline. And this is where there's been some deception in the translation. The language that the Book of Remembrance was originally written in was Paleo-Hebrew. It's a pictographical language that doesn't have or need prepositions. Words such as, after, in, to, on, with, or unto. These were added in to make the text readable in English, but it's also used to distort the meaning. As you can see here, the word H1732 doesn't mean unto David, it just means David. So the verse can be read, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will raise David, a righteous branch and a king, and he shall reign and prosper and shall execute judgment and justice in the earth." Jesus, according to the New Testament, is supposedly the most important character in the history of the world, the creator of all things, incarnated as a living man, and his coming the most amazing event that has ever happened. It is then very puzzling why the Book of Remembrance, which spans the entirety of this last phase of Earth's history, from the beginning with Adam to the last days, and spends entire chapters detailing who begat who, well, this book seems to completely omit the most important event of history, supposedly the event that is the main focus of the entire work. Even the Book of Enoch, section 17, chapters 85 to 89, which provides a summary of the story in the Book of Remembrance, in the form of a parable which has animals representing the main characters in the story. Even in that, he seems to have forgotten about this central character. In this parable, one can readily identify Adam, Eve, Cain, Noah, Ham, Shem, Japheth, Abraham, Isaac, Esau, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, Saul, David, Solomon, Zerubbabel. So why isn't Jesus identifiable in Enoch's dream vision? Is he less important than Joseph or Zerubbabel? Where is the passage about the white bullock that led 12 sheep but was hated by the flock and given to the eagles, and the eagles killed the white bullock, but the bullock came back to life 3 days later and told the 12 sheep that it will come back in a spaceship 2,000 years later and take all the flocks to the happy place? It's simply not there. A good measure of somebody's importance is how often a character is mentioned throughout the Bible, which is the fraudulent combination of the Book of Remembrance and the New Testament. Jesus, or Jesus Christ, is mentioned by name and only appears in the New Testament approximately 968 times. However, David occurs 1,085 times in 930 verses. So if Jesus is the focus of both Testaments, wouldn't he be mentioned more than David? Conclusion: Jesus is not the Messiah. At this point, I would take a look at some of the main prophecies of Jesus that are supposedly in the Book of Remembrance. There are a lot of them, so I think I'm going to make a special video where I go through some of the main ones in detail. But every one that I did take a look at, I found that they were all isolated references, misapplied and taken way out of context. So, who is this Jesus character really? It is said that the name Jesus is a transliteration of the Hebrew name Yahushua, or Joshua in English, which means the Most High is salvation, the same as Joshua, son of Nun, a servant of Moses. And it appears that much of the Jesus story was lifted from that of Joshua. The Most High spoke directly to Joshua. So Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. "Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over the Jordan, thou and all these people, unto the land which I do give unto them, even to the children of Israel. Joshua commanded the Israelites, and they listened to him as they listened to Moses." Joshua chapter 1, verse 10. "Then Joshua commanded the officers of the people, saying, Joshua also selected 12 men to perform tasks for him, the 12 disciples perhaps. Joshua chapter 4 verse 1. And it came to pass, when all the people were clean passed over Jordan, that the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, Take you 12 men out of the people, out of every tribe a man, and command them, saying, Take you hence in out of the midst of the Jordan, out of the place where the priest's feet stood firm, 12 stones, and ye shall carry them over with you, and leave them in the lodging place where ye shall lodge this night. Then Joshua called the 12 men whom he had prepared of the children of Israel, out of every tribe a man. Joshua also parted the waters of the Jordan, just like Moses with the Red Sea. So the people passed over on dry ground. So could that be walking on water, perhaps? Joshua chapter 3, verses 14 to 17. And it came to pass, when people removed from their tents to pass over Jordan, and the priests bearing the ark of the covenant before the people. And as they that bear the ark were come into the Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped in the brim of the water, for the Jordan overfloweth all its banks at the time of the harvest, that the waters that came down from above stood and rose up upon a heap very far from the city Adam that is beside Zaratan. And those that came down towards the sea of the plain, every salt sea, failed and were cut off, and the people passed over right against Jericho. And the priests that bare the ark of the covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the midst of the Jordan. And all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until all the people were passed clean over the Jordan. At Jericho, the Most High told Joshua how to bring down the walls. Joshua chapter 6 verse 2. And the Lord said unto Joshua, See, I have given into thy hand Jericho, and the king thereof, and the mighty men of valor. Joshua also performed a miraculous wonder when he commanded the sun and moon to stay still in the sky in front of the whole of Israel. Joshua chapter 10 verse 12. Then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day that when the Most High delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, Sun, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is it not written in the book of Jasher? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven, and hastened not to go down about a whole day. And there was no day like that before it, or after it, that the Lord hearkened to the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel. So it seems obvious to me that the Jesus story was based on Joshua of Nun, who had 12 men, one from each tribe, helping him. He walked across the water of the River Jordan on dry land, performed miracles, and delivered his people to the Promised Land. So if Jesus isn't Joshua, who is he? Let's see if we can put the clues together. Now, from my research, I've concluded that Satan is a title given collectively to the fallen angels and their host of demons, the disembodied spirits of the Nephilim. And sometimes Satan is applied to one particular fallen angel. So Gad, or Gadriel, was the Satan in the garden. Lucifer is a Satan. And so are Baal, Moloch, and Semyaza, and Azazel. The devils are the chosen people of Satan. The word devil doesn't actually appear in the Book of Remembrance, but the word devils appears four times. The word in modern Hebrew, the Yiddish, is Sayir, which is S-A-apostrophe-I-Y-R, and it means hairy, shaggy, he-goat, demon-possessed goat, and satyr, that's half-man, half-goat. However, there is another word, seer, which is S-E-apostrophe-I-Y-R. But when you apply the rules of Paleo-Hebrew, you find that there is no E, so that would be replaced by an A. So seer is actually the same word as seer. So you can add those additional meanings to the definition. Rough, shaggy, hairy, a Horite, that's a Neanderthal, Mount Seir, where Esau and his children went to live. The word Sair also contains the root word Ayah, I-Y-R, which also means watcher class angel, or those angels that fell. So between all these meanings, you literally get the story of Esau and his descendants, who are the red devils. The word Lord is associated with Jesus, but that word is Baal, one of the Satans. Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 to 15 tells that Lucifer is an angel that fell, known as the Son of the Morning, or Morning Star, Day Star, Shining Star, or Son of the Morning in other versions. Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 to 15. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, Son of the Morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations? So Lucifer is also the same angel that fell in Luke chapter 10, verse 18. And he said unto them, I behold Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Revelation chapter 22, verse 16 reveals Jesus as the morning star or day star. Revelation chapter 22, verse 16. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and offspring of David and the bright and morning star. And in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19, Jesus is also described as the day star. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that you take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star rise in your heart. Interestingly, the Hebrew word for serpent is nakash, which also means to shine. And it's interesting because in Genesis chapter 3, verse 4, the serpent, or the Satan Gadriel, makes a promise. And that's Genesis chapter 3, verse 4. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. But then Jesus makes the same promise to another woman in John chapter 11, verse 26. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? But we know the bright morning star as a planet, which has always been personified as a female Roman goddess, Venus. I'm sensing a little gender fluidity here. I wonder why Jesus is always depicted as a rather effeminate-looking man with long hair, especially when it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 14 and 15, doth not even nature itself teach you that if a man have long hair, it is a shame unto him? And then we have that verse in Revelation that nobody ever seems to stop and think about. Revelation chapter 1, verse 13. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt around the paps with a golden girdle. So what are paps? Well, when you look up at the word in the original Greek, it's mastos, which means female breasts. Well, could it mean male breasts, perhaps? Well, no, because it's also used in Luke. Luke chapter 11, verse 27. And it came to pass, as he spake these things, a certain woman of the company lifted up her voice and said unto him, Blessed is the womb that bare thee, and the paps which thou hast sucked. And if you look up the root of this word, it means handle, squeeze, chew, consume. Not things that happen to a male breast. I would guess the male breast meaning was added later to account for this appearance in Revelation chapter 1, verse 13. The New Testament was written in Greek, and the supreme god of the Greeks is Zeus. The supreme god of the New Testament is called Zeus in Greek, which means son of Zeus. Well, the son of Zeus is Apollo, the sun god, also known as Apollyon, the beast of the pit. The Roman sun god is called Helios, which means sun. And prior to the Romans converted to this religion they made up called Christianity, they worshipped other sun gods, Sol Invictus, Mithras, and Serapis. These are all sun gods, and that is why whenever Jesus is depicted, he always has a bright halo of light around his head. Well, that's the sun, and you're worshipping that, not the bloke standing in front of it. So, putting it all together, We're looking at a half-human, half-angelic demigod connected with the various guises of Satan, with hermaphroditic tendencies, which to me sounds very much like this guy. He has a very obvious, if stylized, penis, just like the several depictions of Jesus, as well as female breasts. And the Baphomet is always holding up the same symbolic hand gesture of his right hand that Jesus is almost always pictured doing, which I hardly think is a coincidence. My conclusion: this Jesus character is Lucifer. So let's examine why I think Jesus and the New Testament were created. Esau and his descendants were and still are the sworn enemies of the Israelites. If you read the Apocrypha and the Book of Jasher, you'll find that the Greeks descend from the Edomite Duke Amalek, and the Romans from Duke Lotan and Duke Zepho. Our enemy is described as a cunning hunter, and a good hunter studies his prey. The Edomites have studied our writings, and they know that when the Most High is with us, then we are unbeatable. No one can stand against us. And they also realize that when we disobeyed the Most High's laws, statutes and commandments, then the Most High would turn his back on us and we would become vulnerable. When the Edomite Greeks took the Israelites captive, the first thing they did was force them to worship Zeus. But that approach failed. Indeed, the first book of Maccabees attests to show how adherence to the law became a rallying point of a robust resistance. By the time of the Edomite Roman captivity, they hit upon the idea of removing the memories of the Israelites and providing them with a new god that they would have to direct their prayers, praise, and attention to, supposedly in order to worship the entity masquerading as the Most High. The Jesus story is not in the Book of Remembrance, nor in the Book of Enoch, because it was added in by the Greco-Roman Edomites, the sworn enemies of the Israelites. 1 Maccabees chapter 3, verse 48, tells how they would write themselves into the book, and laid open the book of the law, wherein the heathen had sought to paint the likeness of their images. And so they forced their new religion upon the Israelites at the point of a sword, to enslave them and keep them inadvertently worshipping a strange god of wood and stone unawares. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 36. And the Lord shall bring thee and thy king which thou shalt set over thee unto a nation which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, and there thou shalt serve other gods, wood and stone. The first and most important commandment is, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Isn't praising, worshipping and praying to the New Testament God, Jesus Christ, breaking the first commandment? The second commandment is, thou shalt not make or bow down to idols. Aren't the crucifix, wooden crosses, paintings of Jesus and statues of Mary and child idols of wood and stone? The followers of certain controlled opposition Hebrew Israelite camps have been fooled using word magic to place this Christ idol before the Most High in exactly the way the Most High commanded us not to. Instead of calling upon the Most High, they are instructed to say the words Yahweh Bah Hashem Yahweh Shai, which means the Most High in the name of Jesus. Well, I have a British passport, and on the first page it says, Her Britannic Majesty's Secretary of State requests and requires in the name of Her Majesty all those to whom it may concern. Now, in that sentence, the one that has the authority is the Queen and not her Secretary of State. The first individual is subordinate to the second. So when the misled Hebrew says, Yahweh Bah Hashem Yahweh Shai, they are placing the Most High in a subordinate position and subject to the authority of Jesus, which is deeply blasphemous and breaks the first commandment every time it's uttered. The Most High says in Isaiah chapter 42, verse 8, I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory I will not give to another, neither my praise to graven images. Now that seems pretty clear to me, as it also says several times that he's a jealous God. So does it make sense that a character can come along and make claims such as this? 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. But grow in grace in the knowledge of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. To him be the glory, both now and forever. Amen. In my humble opinion, this is a major contradiction, and another case of the Most High being placed in a subordinate role to Jesus. Personally, I'm going to go with, thus saith the Most High. People are now waking up to the fact that we are the Israelites, and that we are in the predicament we are in, because we did not keep to the commandments of the Most High, and so incurred the curses of Deuteronomy 28. We are also realizing that the way out of this captivity is to return to the laws, statutes and commandments, or the old covenant, and cry out to the Most High. But doesn't that completely go against the idea of grace and new covenant and the whole point of Jesus? The camps and messianic Israelites, all those who are following the Jesus idol, are finding the story in the Book of Remembrance, because that story is not in the New Testament, with its tales of grace and new covenant. What we're witnessing is a return to the old covenant, a return to the Old Testament, where Jesus cannot be found. The camps and messianic Israelites are busy making YouTube videos because it's plain to see that the so-called Old Testament prophecy is coming to pass in the world today. And yet they still perform verbal gymnastics to try and shoehorn Jesus into the story, even though it's becoming increasingly obvious he just doesn't fit. I just watched a video made by a poor deluded brother whose solution was to throw out the whole 1619 to 2019 400 years prophecy simply because the events of the New Testament haven't happened yet. Duh! The frustrating part of all this for me is that so many of my brothers and sisters of the Hebrew nation are still ensnared in strange religions of wood and stone. If we look back into history, even in captivity, the Israelites would resist the imposition of strange religions. The second book of Maccabees, chapter 7, starkly describes a level of devotion to the law when a whole family is tortured and murdered horribly for refusing the command of the Greek king to eat pork and sacrifice to Zeus. When one realizes that the Jews that refused to convert to Christianity in the Spanish Inquisition were in fact dark-skinned Hebrews, the ancestors of the so-called Negroes scattered across the Americas, sub-Saharan Africa, the Caribbean and throughout the world, then it becomes clear that converting the children of Jacob to this pagan religion was not an easy task. The Inquisition held many events called auto de fe, acts of faith, where the Israelites who stubbornly clung to their law were tortured and burned alive rather than convert to this pagan religion. In one particular Christian act of faith, a young girl was forced to watch her parents undergo cruel torture and then burning before being offered the opportunity to convert and avoid such horrors. The girl appeared to consider the offer, but then broke away and ran headlong into the fire and was consumed. This act of heroism so moved the spectators, and there were lots of spectators watching this, like entertainment, that it halted auto de fes for 12 years. Nonetheless, the Inquisition virtually wiped out the Hebrews living in Spain and Portugal with little success. So their next strategy involved removing the children between the ages of 3 and 14 from their parents and transporting them to the Isle of St. Thomas to be raised as Christians. However, there are accounts of mothers killing their own children rather than have them inducted into this vile religion. Which brings me to the source of my frustration with my Hebrew brothers and sisters. Christianity is not your religion. You were born into it and accept it because your parents accepted it, because they were born into it, all the way back to an ancestor who was tortured into accepting it, or had it force-fed to them as a helpless child. Your ancestors who resisted to their last breath and died in horrifically gruesome ways to avoid conversion will be thoroughly ashamed of their descendants clinging on to this idol with such zeal after their sacrifice to prevent it. I'm not telling you to just renounce this Christ out of hand, but I'm pleading with you to question the narrative that you've been taught. Take some time out to put aside this Jesus, Yeshua, Yahusha, Yahawashi, or whatever alias you have for the Christ God, and read the Book of Remembrance without this idol in your heart. And plug in the fact that the so-called Old Testament was written by and about your ancestors for you at this moment in history. The chances are that if you're listening to this, then you've already awoken to a multitude of lies that you were relentlessly told by the same people who have been hiding the one true creator of all things. And with each lie that you encountered, there was an initial period of disbelief. But there was also something that drove you to look beyond the story that you once believed, until eventually the lie was exposed and a truth became self-evident. This is no different. Thanks for listening.
Wake up! Wake up! Wake up! Wake up!
Wake up!
Come on, come on, wake up, wake up!
Please, wake up.